And welcome to the Lumiere Learning Monday. So our guest today, Rajan Krishnan, philosopher's stone. He's been our Lumiere Learning Monday guest twice. And he's not just done a small session for us. He's done whole day sessions for us. And brace yourself on topics like we've touched upon mythology. We've talked about Krishna versus Rama. You've done a session for us, Rajan, on love and romance, a day-long session. And Rajan has also come and spoken as the expert speaker for our client workshops, where we've had international clients getting a perspective into India through Rajan's views. So during lockdown, as we were curating topics and we were looking to bring in speakers, today, of course, we have a much wider access. We can reach a lot more of you than if you had to come to our office or to get Rajan to trudge to our office on a Monday morning. So this is really convenient. So Rajan, thanks very much for coming here. And even the topic, I'm super excited to talk to you about this area of mythology and how we link it to parenting. So what were some of your thoughts that were going on in your mind on this topic, and where did you kind of see its relevance and significance?
So, multiple things. I do mentor young kids, and my wife also teaches kids, and we see a clear pattern in the way parents look at children today, as children should be overachievers, children should win, children should do this. So there's a lot of pressure that parents put on kids, plus the way children are forced to learn things, and more importantly, our curriculum, the way it's designed. The new NEP is a good step forward, but a lot of things that we teach kids is still based on the way the Britishers left the education system in India. So this basically was based on my learnings of what happens in Puttaparthi, which was value-based education. So I've taken a lot of learnings from there and brought it here. And this is a presentation on different kinds of parenting inspired by the myths. And at the end of the day, I hope each one of us leaves the room being a better parent.
Awesome. So are we going to dive deep in? Are you going to...
Okay. Hello.
Rajan, you can hear me, right?
Yes, I can hear you. Can you guys hear me?
Yes, everyone can hear you. So you want to show us some presentation when you're talking?
For the next 45 minutes, I want to run you through a presentation that I put together, just telling you stories from the myths. And I'm not going to be prescriptive. I'm not going to say do this or do that, because the Indian myths don't do that either. So to start with, the presentation is called Roots and Wings. So first and foremost, I would like to thank my dad and mom who narrated me great stories from being a child. And David Patnaik, who added meaning to the story. So I owe a lot to him too. So the question that I posed earlier is, who is the greatest storyteller in the world? And we shall answer this question at the end of the session. But before that, let me tell you a story. Once upon a time, there was a conference of the gods, and the conference happened in Mount Kailash, where Lord Shiva stays. All the gods were invited, and as it happens, each god has their own respective vahana, or the vehicle. So Ganesha came on the Mushika, Brahma on the Hamsa, Lakshmi came on the Gajanana, Parvati on the Simha, Yama came on the Mahisha, which is the buffalo, Vishnu came on the Garuda, and as you remember, all the gods started walking inside the conference room, and the vahanas were standing in the parking lot. Now, as the gods entered the room, there was a small arch ahead of the room on which sat a small sparrow. Every time a god entered the room, the sparrow will sing a song, and the god would look upon it and bless it, because the song was a stuti, or in praise of the divine lord. All the gods smiled at the sparrow and walked in, except Yama. Yama looked at the sparrow, was very unhappy about something. He smirked and he went in. And this was noticed by Garuda, who was standing outside. Now, Garuda has something called Garuda Drishti, which means he can see for a long distance, and he notices the interaction between Yama and the sparrow. He's very unhappy that Yama has chosen not to smother sparrow, and Garuda feels, as Pakshiraj, as the king of the birds, it is his duty to protect the sparrow. As Yama walks in, Garuda sweeps into action. He picks up the sparrow and he flies across the seven mountains and across the seven rivers and comes and deposits the sparrow on the top of a tree. And then he flies back. By the time he arrives in the evening, the conference is over, all the gods are coming out. And that's Garuda for you. And that's a conference in progress, conference is over. And as their conference is over, he finds Vishnu and Yama coming together. Hello, can you hear me? Hello?
We can hear you, Rajan.
Okay, okay. And Vishnu and Yama are coming together. So Yama looks up and he smiles. So Vishnu says, Yama, why are you smiling? So Yama says, you see, there was a sparrow in the morning and I was wondering that the sparrow was to be eaten by a python at the bottom of a tree in Dandakaranya. I wonder how it flew there.
Okay.
Yep. Now look at it. Now this is a perspective. Now who is right? Is Yama right? Or Deepa, can everybody else see the screen? Is my only question.
We can't see your presentation yet. We can hear you speak.
I wonder why, because I had asked Rohan, because that should be share screen.
There is a share screen with you.
Okay, let me share the screen then. Can you see it now?
Yes, we can see the python.
Okay, I'll just run you through the visuals again. So Kailash, the various Vahanas, Yama, Garuda, the meeting getting over, and the two people coming together. And finally, all you see is the python. Now the question that is often asked is, who is right? Is Yama right or the python right? Like it happens in all our myths, Garuda is left bewildered. Hey, listen, I did my duty. Yama says, I did mine. And therefore, this is the big thing. In Hinduism and in all our epics, there is a perspective. It is not the perspective, it is a perspective. It is a truth. You have to either accept it or reject it. It's up to you. Secondly, this is all based on my personal observations, conversation experiences. Therefore, yours may be completely contrary to what I have said. So the chance is you either act or react on it. But we progress only if there is samvad and not vivad. Vivad is what happens in the parliament and on news. But we progress as a team only when we discuss. Now, let's be very clear, why were these epics written in the first place? A lot of people think that these epics were written at one point of time. Yeh mythology hai, yeh jhoot hai, isme koi sach nahi hai. But remember, it is called itihasa for a reason. Itihasa means the person who wrote it played an important role in the epic. He was physically present and he's narrating what he saw. The epics were written at a time when Buddhism and Jainism were in a rise across India. And Buddhism and Jainism celebrated the hermit. The Ramayana and Mahabharata celebrate the householder. There's a fundamental conflict between the hermit and the householder. The hermit says, Dunya ko tyag do. The householder says, no, sansar mein uljo. And therefore, if you look at both the epics are about kings and kinship. It's a property dispute in both of them. And both of them are about dharma. Dharma, as explained, is Matsya Nyaya, where the powerful protect the weak. So we come to the relevance of mythology in a VUCA world. It was the subject that we began with. So you know what the perspective is. Now, what is VUCA? Some of us know this, which is volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. But this is what it looks like. It's something that comes and completely shocks you. You don't know what's hit you. Now, something like this that happened a few months ago, an import from China. And on 24th of March, there was a national lockdown as announced by the Prime Minister. The next day onwards, we had the mythological shows on TV. Ramayana, Mahabharata, Sri Krishna, and Har Har Mahadev. For the first time, since I work with a few brands, Star Plus with Star, we know for a fact that this had unprecedented viewership across the country. We had never seen so many people see mythologicals like this. Remember, this is not a new show. This doesn't have a production value for Game of Thrones. It's a 33-year-old show. Some of the kids were not even born, and probably some of the parents were not even born at that time. And look at the lineage, 33 years old, 32 years, 27. The Har Har Mahadev was probably 9 years old. And the question is, why did people come and watch mythologicals of all things? So when there's a sense of pervading gloom and doom, we are all scared, we are all anxious. And in a world of uncertainty and unpredictability, we crave for the familiar, we seek a comfort zone. a zone that is trustworthy, reassuring, and a part of our cultural upbringing and DNA. Moreover, if you lead to a lot of WhatsApp posts and a lot of other things flowing around in social media, it's about how Mother Nature is rectifying the ills that we have abused upon it. And it is the nature's way of cleansing the planet. And we are not a God-loving nation by any mile, but we are a God-fearing nation, and we believe that whenever things are going wrong, the divine shall intervene. So what do we do when we are in trouble? We often go to the temple. Now this is a time when you couldn't even go to the temple. So this was a great time where the divine force came into your house via the TV. It was auspicious, talismanic, and sacred. It's almost a reassurance that the divine is with you. The big learning from this epic saw, while times change, values are eternal. And there's also a gnawing guilt among most parents that they don't spend enough time with their own children inculcating those values. So these myths are reaffirmation of time-tested values. It's a great time of nostalgia, family bonding, and familiarizing the young generation with these epics. Now look at that. That's a form that all of us have seen. And adjacent to that form is a line which says, whenever dharma declines society, I shall manifest to restore order. And that is a belief that we are all driven by, that in times of VUCA, which is when things are volatile, chaotic, ambiguous, God is our most trusted navigator. And that's one big reason why we came back to mythologicals. Do you see something surprising in the American dollar note? It says, in God we trust. Remember, it's the most capitalist country in the world. And even they put God right on the dollar bill. So trust in God is not only an Indian phenomena. It's a global phenomena. In various forms, we respect and look at him. Come to India and we look at the corruption and crime in India. Look at all these names. I'm sure you must have heard some of them while you read the newspapers in the last 5 years. And you wonder, why is India slowly turning into a crime capital of the world? Probably because this is missing. A clear moral compass. A moral compass which tells you what's right and what's wrong. Now these are epics and images from epics which are embedded in our psyche. Ravana, Duryodhana, Dushasana, and we wonder, ye log aise kyu the? Because they say that the Ram and the Ravan both coexist in us. And they say there are two wolves inside us. And the question is, which one do you feed every day? Do you feed the Ram in you or the Ravan in you? During our conversations over the last 10 years with a lot of parents, we found this very simple truth that parents are very busy gifting their children wings to be independent and fly away, but they forget to give them roots, which makes them rooted and gives them a place to come back. So the belief is times change, values are eternal. And the purpose of this entire presentation is, how do we inculcate the right set of values in children at a very impressionable age? So this is a quote I picked up from Sathya Sai, which says, if there's righteousness in the heart, there's beauty in character. Beauty in character leads to harmony in home. Harmony in home leads to order in the nation. And order in the nation leads to the peace in the world. Yep. So as all the psychologists would tell you, children don't do what parents say, children do what parents do. So with that, let me tell you the story of three mothers. Three mothers who are extremely powerful and influential, and look at what they do to their own kids. The first is the story of the cursed child. Queen Padmavati is raped by a Gandharva. She consumes poison to kill the child, but the child clings onto her womb. She curses the unborn child, saying that you will be killed by a Yadava one day. And the child grows up without the mother's love. The child grows up in hatred and he gives hatred back. And as you guessed right, that is Kamsa. The moment he hears that his sister's child shall kill him one day, he goes to kill her first. The husband promises, don't worry, I'll give you every newborn child. And that's what he does. He tries to kill every newborn child until the eighth one, until the seventh one rises and says, don't worry, your killer lives elsewhere. And that's the birth of Krishna. Krishna grows up, he's transported. And look at that. He's told that a child will kill him. And a child does come and kill him in the end. Remember, it all starts with the curse of the mother. Look at another mother. And I'm sure this would have been played in most TV serials. And you would have seen her too, Gandhari. She deliberately chooses to blindfold herself because her husband is blind, because she's angry at what destiny has laid for her. But when she blindfolds herself, she also blindfolds herself to her children. Every time the children come to her, she pushes them away. And look at what the child does. The child poisons the Pandavas. The child burns the house, but she turns a blind eye. And that's Duryodhana for you. Majestic, but wicked. Look at every act of his, just because he was not punished when he was a child and he grew up to be a monster. In the end, when the Kurukshetra is on, his mother finally says, "I'll remove my blindfolds and ensure that you're invincible." But he covers himself in a fig leaf, and then you know the rest is history. Bhima breaks his thigh and kills him. Now that is Gandhari lamenting over the death of Duryodhana. But when Krishna comes to pay condolences, she curses Krishna. She doesn't take the blame for being a bad mother. She tells Krishna, "You are the one who's the cause of all suffering." And he says, "Just like you killed my son, your entire race will die and so will you." And that's exactly what happens. Krishna's son dresses up like a woman and he delivers a mace. The mace is ground into fine powder and then the great battle ensues among the Yadavas and Krishna is shot dead. So if you look at the two epics, Rama commits suicide and Krishna is murdered. Very gory deaths for extremely powerful heroes. And that's Krishna ascending the heavens. Why? Because he was cursed by a woman, a mother. Look at the over-pampered child. You've all seen this character. But do you know whose father, from what lineage he belongs to? Now look at his lineage. His great-grandfather was Agastya. Grandfather was Pulastya. Father, Vaishrava. And look at his siblings, Kubera and Vaishrava. But his father marries a Rakshasi who's dressed up like an Apsara. So while he gets all the knowledge from the father, he gets the wickedness from the mother. And the father leaves the mother and walks away because he realizes she's inculcating the wrong values in him. So he becomes a powerful man. But the wickedness in him grows. So one day he goes to Kailash and he finds Shiva meditating. And he finds a very gorgeous looking woman standing there. And he says, "Ye toh badi sundar hai yaar." So when Shiva opens his eyes, he says, "I love this woman. Can I take her with me?" And that woman is Parvati. So Shiva says, "Yeah, please take her with you. I don't mind." As Shiva is called Bholenath, he says, "Ravana is asking me for something. I better give it to him." So Shiva says, "Take Parvati with you." Parvati looks around and realizes that if I listen to my husband, life will not be so good. And the first thing she does is she looks around and she finds a tiny little frog sitting there. She converts the frog into her replica of hers. And the replica is what Ravana takes with her. So the frog converted into a replica of Parvati is called Mandodari. Manduka, which means frog. Now look at it. Just because the mother did not instill the right values, he thought everything that's around him belongs to him. It doesn't stop there. And he covets more. Remember this? So every time he finds a beautiful woman, he finds it's his fundamental right to own her. At the end of the Ramayana, when the war is over, Ravana is fallen down and he's on the edge of death. Rama tells Lakshmana, "Please go to Ravana and take all the wisdom and the knowledge that he has." Lakshmana does go to Ravan, but he comes out empty-handed. So Rama says, "What did you tell Ravan?" So I told him, "Give me your knowledge." No, he says, "No, if you are seeking knowledge, you better bend down at his feet, although he's your enemy." So Lakshmana bows down to Ravana. Ravana imparts the knowledge and then he dies. So therefore you look at Ravana in some of the South Indian temples, you find this figure of his as a knowledgeable Vedic Pandit who knew everything. He was a composer of music. He's credited with creating the Rudraveena. The Shiva Tandava Stotram comes from him. Knowledgeable, but yet wicked. Look at three heroes, Kamsa, Duryodhana and Ravana. So what's the root for the negativity? Somebody failed to wrap them on the knuckles at the right time. Let's look at three other mothers. And let me show you the pictures. Just observe carefully and tell me what you see. There's Parvati with Ganesha and Kartikeya. Some more paintings from the Mughal era and from the Tanjavur school. Some more pictures. What's the one thing that strikes you about them? Now look at that. That's Sita with the two children. And that's Kunti with her children. You see a pattern. They're all single mothers. The absconding father. Because in Indian mythology, there are no iconic husbands and no iconic fathers. Show me one. None. Is Rama a great husband? Answer is no. Is Shiva a great father? Answer is no. Because Indian men remain mama's boys. And that's the truth. In mythology, there are no great fathers, no great husbands. And the Seegram's ad is true of that. Why? Because in alpha male society, in the men think it is they are providers and protectors. And the women are nurturers and nourishers. And therefore, my job is to provide and protect, but not to take care of anything of the kids. Now look at this. But are women only nurturers and nourishers is a fundamental question we ask. Now look at these visuals. The absence of men. And if men do exist, they exist at a base level. Look at the throne of Rajarajeshwari. It is held by the men on the right-hand side. Look at that. Powerful images of Kamakshi of Kanchipuram, Meenakshi of Madurai, Solis, Gayatri, Ashtalakshmi. Look at the Trinity. And even on the right-hand side, it says that the top three Trinity do not exist without the bottom three. So without Vidya, Brahma cannot create. Without Shakti, Shiva cannot destroy. And without Lakshmi, Vishnu cannot sustain the world. So the goddesses are autonomous. They don't need the gods to be worshipped. But all the gods require the goddesses to be worshipped, except the few exceptions being the celibate gods like Hanuman. The question that is often asked to me is, who is Kali and who is Durga? Are they the same? The answer is no. Kali is the darker form of Parvati. So the wild Parvati is called Kali. The domesticated Parvati is called Gauri or Annapurna. So one tends to the kitchen and the other tends to the battlefield. And that is Durga. What is Durga? Durga is the feminine energies of the gods. She is not born of a womb. She is formed from the Shakti or the energies of the male gods. But if you look at most of the iconography, you'll find that the concept of the mother goddess and everything emanating from her, even the gods bow down to her. And to that, they say that without Lakshmi, Vidya or Shakti, the world cannot be enlightened, enriched or empowered. So the women are the value custodians is something that's very, very critical. Therefore, the role of the mother becomes even more powerful as we go along. Let me tell you another story of a single mother. So story goes, there's a lady called Anasuya who is barren for a long time, doesn't have kids. And at the same time, there is a debate among the three goddesses up there saying, who's the most virtuous woman? So the three goddesses go up to the respective lords and ask them, who is the most virtuous woman on planet Earth? So without blinking an eye, the men say, there's a lady called Anasuya, she's the most virtuous. She said, how can you even say that in front of you are the three goddesses of the who run the universe? She says, no, in terms of virtuosity, in terms of being chaste, there's nobody better than Anasuya. She says, let's test them. The three gods take on the format of three hermits and they come to Anasuya's house and ask her, we are hungry, can you feed us? Anasuya says, definitely, please take a bath, come back. They go to the river, take a bath and come back. And the moment she's about to feed them, she says, wait. You cannot feed us with your clothes on. Please remove all your clothes and then feed us. Anasuya says, what a strange request from a sannyasi. So she looks at them and she says, okay. In a blink of an eye, she converts the three sadhus who are the Trinity into three babies. And the moment they convert into babies, they suckle on her breast and then they grow up with her. She feeds them. Now, time passes and the goddesses get very anxious because their husbands are respectively sitting with another woman and getting well fed. And they come to the husbands and say, please come back. Now, if you tell a man that please come back, the man knows between his mother and his nagging wife, he has a better choice of staying with his mother and eating well than being nagged with the wife. And therefore, The three husbands said, "No, we are very happy with Mother Anusuya." So they fall at Anusuya's feet and say, "Please give our husbands back." Anusuya says, "But I cannot give the children away." So the three Trinity leave a portion of her themselves with Anusuya, and that becomes Dattatreya. What's the moral of this story? That even the gods crave for mother's love. Now look at it. Vishnu and Shiva are Swayambhu. They don't have a mother. Brahma is born out of Vishnu's navel. He doesn't have a mother. Even the gods crave for it. And that's something that is a great learning as you go along. There's this entire happy family myth in India. That now if you look at most of the pictures that you see around on the walls, they all show pictures like this. The one on the left is a complete misnomer because Lav Kusha never sit with Sita on the throne. Now, when have you seen a happy family? We all pose for this. It's all in part of our albums. Part of albums. Happy family. But most families are dysfunctional. This never happens. Let me tell you one story of a family that sits together and how it provokes a rivalry. This is a story about two siblings, Kartikeya and Ganesha, who are great brothers. One day, Narada comes to them and says, "Hey, listen, I've got a nice juicy mango I'd like to share with y'all." He gives it to Shiva and says, "Please give it to your kids." Now, you know how fathers are, you know, they don't think too much. They say, "Well, why don't the two of you go on a race? Whoever wins the race gets the mango." And that's how you trigger rivalry. Instead of cutting into two halves, he says, "Let's have a race." Very male attitude. So off the gods go. So Kartikeya and Ganesha sit on the respective vahanas and go away. So Kartikeya goes around the universe once, twice, and Ganesha goes around his parents and he gets the mango. Now look at the moral of the story. Ganesha says, Kartikeya says, "How can you win it? I'm the one who came first. You never even moved from here." So Ganesha says, "You went around the world. I went around my world." If you look at it very carefully, Ganesha is nurtured by Parvati. Kartikeya is not born to Parvati. He's the warlord, always spends time away. And therefore nurturing makes a big difference to the way they see the life and the world. How do you rectify a rivalry? Let's tell you one story from the Ramayana. So Rama promises Sugriva, "Don't worry, I'll ensure that the kingdom comes to you." And between Rama and Sugriva and Vali are fighting, he shoots the arrow. Sugriva says, "What? You had no business interfering between two brothers. And you shot me from the back." So Rama says, "I'm sorry." So he says, "Sorry doesn't help, na Baba." So come the Mahabharata. Look at Krishna. He tells Arjuna, "Shoot the son of Karna." Do you think these are related or unrelated stories? They are both related. Why? Because in the Ramayana, Rama helps the son of Sugriva and kills the son of Indra. In the Mahabharata, Krishna helps the son of Indra and plots the murder of Surya's son. So the equations are balanced. And for what Rama did in the Ramayana, Vali comes in the form of a hunter and kills Krishna. So in God's books, everything is balanced. So they say in India or in Hinduism, God is not a judge. He's an accountant. वो हिसाब किताब रखते हैं. वो ये नहीं कहते तुम सही हो या गलत हो. Therefore, the Kauravas go to heaven after war and the Pandavas go to hell. Because these are books of accountancy where debit and credit matters and not what's right or wrong. Look at the next story, the story of the underdog. One day there's a fight between all the vegetables. Every vegetable says, "I am superior, I am better." So they say, "Let's go to Vishnu because he is an impartial judge." So all the vegetables land at Vishnu's door and Vishnu is just woken up from his sleep. So they ask Vishnu, "Which is the greatest vegetable in the universe?" So Vishnu says, "The onion." So everybody says, "How can the onion be? Onion is an impure thing. Most people don't even touch it." So Vishnu says, "No. When you cut the onion horizontally, you find the chakra. And you cut it vertically, you find the shankha. The shankha and the chakra, which are important for me, and therefore the onion is most my favorite." Well, look at this. There are why are these stories told? Because there are embedded layers saying there's nothing right or wrong. Everything has its place and everything is a matter of perspective. Look at Opat offering a perspective. After the Kurukshetra war is over, there's a huge fight between Bhima and Arjuna. Each one claims, I am the greatest hero because I am the one who went and killed and made a difference to the war. They go to Krishna and Krishna says, listen, I was too busy riding the chariot. I didn't see. So I don't know which of the two of you is greater. However, there is that mountain outside Kurukshetra on the top of which there's a tree. On the top of the tree, there's a head. And the head saw everything. Let's go to the head and ask it. So the Pandavas and Krishna troop over the mountain. They come to the head and ask him, hey, who's greater, Bhima or Arjuna? So the tree says, who's Bhima? Who's Arjuna? No, he says, we are the Pandavas and we kill the Kauravas. He says, who's the Pandava? Who's the Kaurava? So Bhima says, tune dekha kya? What did you see from up there? So he says, I saw stupid, foolish kings fighting, Krishna's Sudarshan Chakra chopping their heads, and Mother Earth drinking their blood with glee. Now look at the perspective. Who is the hero? Arjuna, Bhima, or the one who's the great puppeteer who made things happen? So life is all about perspective. And that's something that we must remember as we go along. Let me tell you a story of two teachers. And because this is critical, because we normally look at this line. You remember what's the national award for the best teacher in sports called in India? It's called Dronacharya Award. It's given every year to the best sports coach. But is he a good teacher? Is a fundamental question. He's a great teacher for the Pandavas and the Kauravas. He's a great warrior. But yet, and look at the way he's killed. Yudhishthira says Ashwatthama is dead because Bhima kills an elephant. And Draupadi's brother, Drishtad Yamuna, knocks his head off. Why is a guru killed in such a merciless fashion? It's a question that a lot of people ask. Did he deserve this? Oh, guru hai. Guru ki aisi hatya kyun kare? But if you rewind back, you realize Dronacharya one day sees his wife giving his child a glass of milk. But it's not milk. Because they are so poor, she mixes ash with water and says, this is milk. Dronacharya is heartbroken that he has reached a poverty which is unseen. So he says, let me go to my friend and ask him for some monies. He goes to his childhood friend who's now a king called Drupada and says, will you give me some money or some cows? Drupada chases him away, kicks him out. At the same time, Krishna treats his childhood friends, Sudama, with great pomp. Drupada comes out, he has Hastinapur, becomes a teacher, and when the Pandavas and Kauravas have finished education, they ask him, sir, what is the Guru Dakshina you want? Guess what he says? He says, I want Drupada's head. Is that a great teacher? And then, after Drupada is defeated in battle, he doesn't kill him. Drupada goes and performs a sacrifice and he asks for two children. Children who will come and ruin the Kuru clan. So Drishtad Yamuna and Draupadi, both are born in adult forms and they are born out of vengeance to destroy. And that's exactly what happens. Draupadi is disrobed and she says, I shall drink your blood. I shall wash my hair with blood. And the entire Mahabharata war is fought because Dronacharya fails to instill values in the Kauravas. Therefore, look at Dronacharya. He's all about anger, vindictiveness, pride, insecure, nepotism. And yet we celebrate him as a great teacher. Look at the other guru, Sandipani, who's Krishna's teacher. And look at Krishna's humility. And this is stressed even further when you look at this. Krishna prefers to be a charioteer. And only once does he pick up arms and Arjuna says, Bhaiya, tu apna kaam kar, come and ride the chariot. Don't do all these things. And there's another hero called Karna, who's a charioteer's son, but he wants to become king. And look at what happens to him. He dies. So the son of a cowherd is very comfortable with his roots. He chooses to be a charioteer. Always the kingmaker, never the king. The son of a charioteer, Karna, is uncomfortable with his roots. And therefore, he becomes a king, but never gets a respect. Look at these three heroes, Bhishma, Drona, and Kanna. Do you know what's common to all three of them? And the death is celebrated by the two of them. What is common between these three mighty heroes, Bhishma, Karna, and Dronacharya? They have a same guru, Parshuram. And Parshuram imparts weaponry, doesn't instill values. Now look at it. Three great heroes, powerful, but bereft of values, and therefore the Mahabharata happens. So the role of religion even more gets accentuated even further. Let's look at fatherhood. Look at what Dashrata prays for. By the way, Dashrata already has a child before Rama is born. He has a daughter called Shanta, whom he gives away in adoption because he says she's not fit enough to be the king. He does the Putra Kameshti Yagna, means I'm craving for a son. Please give me a son. He gets 4. On the other hand, when his son goes, look at the way he's heartbroken. On the other hand, Janaka finds a daughter and he's elated with it. So a father not happy with the daughter and craving for a son, and a father happy with a daughter. So when Rama goes into the forest on exile, Dashrata dies heartbroken. Janaka says, don't worry. My daughter is qualified enough, educated enough, and has enough wisdom to withstand the travails of the forest. Look at the two perspectives of the two fathers. We come to the fag end of the presentation where we look at the tough father. One is about Vishnu. So the story goes that one day, Narada finds a very gorgeous looking woman taking a bath in the waters of this Mansarovar. He comes and tells Vishnu, Pitaji, he should call Pitashri, I have fallen in love with a woman, I want to marry her. So Vishnu looks at him and says, listen, you can't marry. It is not written in your destiny. So he looks at his mother and says, Mate, tum samjhao, because dad is being tough, and that's what all kids do, right? They negotiate with the father. If the father doesn't yield, they go to the mother, and mother being more malleable of the two, she says, why not? Then he tells Vishnu, look at you. When Lakshmi came out of the waters, you just grabbed her and married her. If you have a right to marry the person you love, why can't I? And he says that, look at you. You go and help out everybody. You help cook, you help elephants, you help human beings. You come in different avatars to help different people. And here is your son craving for a woman, and why can't you give it to her? Vishnu says, since you're crying so much, what do you want? He says, on the day of her swayamvar, I want to land there as a prince. Vishnu says, Tathastu. So Narada gets up in the morning, rushes to the swayamvar hall, and he finds himself decked in great finery. The girl comes out of the swayamvar hall with a garland in hand. She looks at Narada and bursts out laughing and goes and garlands another man. Narada is heartbroken. He comes out and he finds his reflection in the waters, and he finds that Vishnu has given him the body of a prince, but the face of a monkey. And then he curses Vishnu and he says, just as you have deprived me of a woman, you too shall be separated from a woman, and that time a monkey like me shall come and help you. And thus begins the Ramayana. A tough father getting cursed for his effort. And look at the next one, which is the story of Rama. This is at the fag end of the Ramayana. Normally it's never narrated, but this is a very popular story. At the end of the Ramayana, Sita goes back to her mother Earth, and Rama is waiting out there saying, when will death come upon me? So life flashes in front of him. He sees his entire life as whatever happened. And he realizes, I want to be with Sita, yaar. I can't stay on earth anymore. He's put Lavakusha on the throne and he wants to go away. So he tells Yama, why don't you come and take me? So Yama says, I'll come back to this. So Yama says, listen, I cannot come to Ayodhya because there's a monkey called Hanuman sitting there. And as long as Hanuman is protecting you, I cannot take away your life. So Rama realizes, how do I get rid of this monkey now? Like we say, how do I get rid of the monkey off my back? So Rama devises a plan. So one day Rama calls Ravana to the palace and he's toying with this mudrika or this ring. The ring falls down, it rolls on the floor, it goes and falls in a crevice. He tells Hanuman, hey, listen, without the mudrika, I'm no longer king. Can you go and retrieve the mudrika for me? Ravana jumps into the crevice, and as the crevice goes deeper and deeper and deeper, he finally comes to a place where there are hundreds and thousands of mudrikas lying around. And there is the saying, there's a huge snake called Vasuki lying there. And Vasuki says, every time a Rama has to die, a ring falls and a monkey comes in search of it. And that's how the Ramayana ends. And that's how Rama enters a Sarayu and he's gone forever. And he joins Lakshmi in Vaikuntha. So they say that whenever the Ramayana is narrated, there's always a place kept empty. Because they say that empty space is for Hanuman to come and listen to the story. So, at home, when you're narrating a story, ensure you please empty a seat so that the monkey at home, that the child can come and sit and listen. Now you look at multiple stories today. You looked at flawed children, single mothers, powerful women, sibling rivalry, teachers, fatherhood. What does it tell you fundamentally? I didn't give you any lessons from it. But when you heard it, probably a penny dropped here and there. And you said, oh, that's true. That is true. That is also true. Because all of them are about five fundamental values. So, Satya, Dharma, Shanti, Prema, and Ahimsa. In multiple ways, there are multiple tables like these available on the net. You can always go through them. There are tons and tons of values. And we started with a simple question. Who was the greatest storyteller in the world? And I always say it's the mother in every home. Because nobody tells a story better than the mother does. Because the mother adds so much more to the story that the child relives the story again and again. So to end, there are only two lasting benefits, bequests we give our children. One is roots, the other is wings. That's it.
Lovely. So Nikhil Shah has been listening and giving his feedback from time to time. Really lovely. Nikhil, yes, absolutely. We've enjoyed. You'll have to stop sharing your screen.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Yeah. So Kumi Vivaina is saying, delightful. I did not want him to stop. So Rajan, when you were putting this together, you know, these are stories that you've learned along the way. You heard them as kids. How did this deep understanding of mythology come onto you? When did you get interested in these stories? And
See, the stories always existed in some form or the other. But to be honest with you, it's thanks to Devdutt, because it's my interaction with him and reading his book, listening to his lectures, that you realize that he decoded them at a very different level. And I would recommend everyone pick up a book or two of his and read, because there's so much of wisdom that he has put. I would call him the modern day Valmiki, because Valmiki only wrote the story. This guy has decoded it beautifully. You look at Jaya, Sita, and all his works, they are brilliant explanations of what happens behind the story.
And like you said, it's itihasa, so it's also possibly Devdutt's interpretation, right?
Yes.
So he always gives that disclaimer. Right?
That's right. It's his point of view.
And of all these mothers you've told us about, which mother do you think is the one who's possibly the you know, which story or which myth really has most relevance for our VUCA times today, Rajan?
See, they in the Ramayana is a lovely line. This is, you know, kuputra ho sakta hai kumata nahi, which means they can never be a bad mother. They can always be a bad son. So for me, all mothers are beautiful and gorgeous. The thing is, what do you imbibe? You know, there's nothing wrong in today's mothers either. The only thing is, the Ramayana and Mahabharata are not part of a cultural upbringing at all. For example, if the education ministry were to say, hey man, instead of Jules Verne, 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea as a primer for schools, why can't we have the Ramayana and Mahabharata as a special read? It would really enable children to appreciate these texts.
What do you think of Amar Chitra Katha and the role they played in our lives growing up? I mean, all of us grew up on Amar Chitra Katha, and then they got rewritten and now they're available in so many other forms. As a great fan.
They really stoked our imagination. They really made us more curious about it. In fact, there are a lot of characters about which I never knew. Then my dad would say, no, go and read the Amar Chitra Katha. Then I would read it and then come back with more stories. And then as you go along, there are other authors who come along the way and who enrich your understanding. There's Ramesh Menon, Vivek Debray, Shakuntala. There's so many of them who have written great books. And Nandita Krishnan, you know, there are many authors who have added a lot of value to books here. I think it's just about picking them and reading at any point of time. In fact, I had a tough time choosing this because there's so many of it. And by the way, you ran through 180 slides.
So what's the role for the dad in all this storytelling?
Narrate it. See, because it's narrate the story. Because the thing is, we find that fathers mostly take the foot of the accelerator. See, they are all like Shiva. They are all hermits caught in their own worlds. You know, sometimes just sit in, tell the story. And the child loves listening to these stories. Yeah. They say the first Ramayana is told by Shiva to Parvati. It's not written by Valmiki. And therefore, you know, there is a lot of merit in telling stories because stories actually shape our imagination. They shape our intellect, the way we look at life itself. And there's so much of richness in these stories here. And as I said, Indian stories are not prescriptive. You look at the Jataka, you look at all the books in India. They never prescribe this is a moral of the story. They tell the story and it's for you to deduce it.
Very nice. So I must share over here for people who are watching, you know, kids are also great storytellers. So one of our alumni, Rajan, Archana Sohni, she's created something called Lockdown Diaries, where kids actually illustrate and tell stories.
Sure.
That gets shared to a community of moms and kids. So it's really her way of developing the imagination and getting kids to learn the tool of telling stories. And it's beautiful. In fact, I've also invited Archana to your session quite likely. She's listening. To the audience, we've come in here to listen to Rajan blow our minds literally about so many aspects about and little known facts. Some of us possibly know it. Many of us have grown up on Amarchitra Katha. We believe that that's like the first, key that we give our kids to unlock Indian mythology and stories. And at someone who believes that the Mahabharata and Ramayana and it also operates at a deep metaphorical level. So there is the realism of it, and then there is the whole dimension of the metaphor behind each of these stories. So it's really about what one will pick up. It's like watching a movie several times or reading a book at different times in your life. And at each of those life stages, that film or that book or that piece of music talks to you in a way that's very different. So how do we build an interest in discovery? How do we build curiosity? How do you fire the imagination? How do you get into dialogue? I think I learned a lot of these things, Rajan, in listening to you, that is ultimately about so many facets. There is no one truth, but it's really about the perspective, and it's really the willingness to sit down, debate, discuss, like the Shankaracharya. You know, it's not about, it's actually going and having a conversation and being able to bring in perspectives. And also, I think the need to listen to different perspectives and different stories, like Chimamanda Adichie says that there are many stories. So thank you very, very much for coming in, Rajan. And for all of you watching today, and some of you who couldn't come in early on, you can go to the YouTube channel and you can, listen to the whole talk. It's there. You might want to watch it again with your family, with your kids, sit down together and watch. Sorry about that. We didn't start all the slides at the same time, but I think it was just a wonderful experience having you here.
Thank you.
Thanks, Rajan.
Anytime.
Thanks for watching, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.